Welcome back, everybody, to the DreamHack Winter 2015 Grand Prix. I am Frodan, and it's time to finish out our Swiss rounds. It's round 9, and I'm joined right now by Lothar and Raven. It's been quite a journey so far. 9 rounds, hundreds, if not thousands of games by now, but it's finally coming to a conclusion, at least for the beginning portion. Then we start getting to the meaty playoffs with 16 players.
But it's still not the end of the journey for the players if they want to, you know, get points and the prize.
Yes.
Because the prize pool is divided for the top 8. Mm-hmm. So there's basically still two...
And the points, right?
And the points, yes. So it's basically still 2 rounds away from, you know, having something from being here.
That's right. I think getting a top 16 is going to be a big relief, though, because
the
playing through Swiss, it's a great format, but it is long and a lot of games to play through. So I think, especially because there's a lot of matches now that are so close to it, I win this, I'm through, lose, elimination. So it's really important to just get to that top 16 spot.
There's a lot of uncertainty. You just don't know who you're playing against next. And you have to be really mindful that it's a Swiss field versus when you have the 16 players and you know exactly who you're matching up against, you can kind of at least predict and start thinking and preparing. But right now, a lot of times between rounds, you sit there and just wait because you're not sure. And boy, what a couple of matchups we have coming up here. Our first on stream will be RDU versus Gaara. This is for elimination, essentially. Either of these guys lose, their journey stops here. But these are two very talented people that you would not be surprised to see in the top 16 at all. But only one of them can go through.
And it's kind of sad to see that both of the players super experienced, as you said, and attending almost every single DreamHack, if I remember correctly. I think RDU was actually at every single DreamHack that was played with Hearthstone. Apart from DreamHack Valencia.
Okay.
And Gaara, what about Gaara?
Gaara's been to most of them as well. In fact, both of these guys are DreamHack champions.
Yeah.
They were the first 2 DreamHack champions.
Actually, that's an interesting fact, which is very often forgotten by a lot of people, including myself. So
they were both the breakout performances, right? Gaara's first tournament that he kind of played in was that, and RDU actually placed top 4 in that DreamHack Bucharest. And then following up in summer, RDU was able to win that event, most famously taking Amaz in that finals, followed by some controversy thereafter. But I think RDU grew up a lot since then, and he's definitely gotten much more mature as a player and as a person.
Definitely.
Really enjoying to see where he is these days. But I do know that, you know, as much as RDU has come a long way, he's still going to be really salty. If you go 6-2 and lose in round 9, it's just like, God, you know, you have such a good record overall. You know, 67-70% win rate's really fantastic in Swiss, but just not good enough. You need to be a little bit better.
Yeah, because I wasn't sure if 1-6-3 might advance into the top 16, but no, I'm almost certain there will be no case in that. Like that.
The
other way. The 1-7-2 might be not advancing.
Yeah, which is really heartbreaking if you think about it. If a 7-2 player doesn't make it, it's like, man, that stinks. Like, what if it's the winner of this match? It's like they have in their super intense series, it goes to game 5, which it realistically could.
Yeah, and that's pretty much worst case scenario as well, because it's like you're the 1-7-2 who didn't get through. Like, it's so rough.
I know the pain. I was twice the 9th player in national championships of Water World at TCG with a 6-1 record.
You almost think it's like potentially worse than just bombing out early on or something, because it's like you were so close and you had the same score, obviously without tiebreak, as the other 7-2s that went through. But is this a patron mirror?
This is patron versus patron, I guess.
Yeah, it's patron mirrors, which is always fun to watch. It's like the old times with the inner rage and the whirlwind effects.
Yeah, both players have Deathbite into patron as well, ready for turn 5. So that's going to be really interesting to see who can actually pull that one off first and sort of gain the advantage.
Gaara has the coin, which might be the advantage of having one whirlwind effect more than an opponent. But RDU has the first initiative, right?
Yeah, and even that actually just drawing into Fiery War Axe is pretty good, because there's no decent turn to play here for Gaara other than just arming up at the moment. But being able to get the Fiery War Axe, because normally it's not something you think is too great versus Warrior early on. It's not too many minions you want to get rid of, but versus Patron, it can just remove straight away. And even the Acolyte of Pain, as you can see, that is in Gaara's hand.
Do you think Gaara would just go for Acolyte of Pain this turn?
Now, from the coin?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is very clever for RDU that he didn't play the Fiery War Axe, because that would practically just deny Garry playing the Acolyte of Pain, but this way he denies getting more card potential for Garry, right? Because he did bluff that he doesn't have the War Axe.
Yeah, there's also, it's not like RDU had a particular turn 3 play anyway, so he's not lost anything by going Fiery War Axe next. And that's Ragnaros.
That's a Ragnaros
in the deck.
I suppose, well, to a certain extent, one of the problems Patron has, like, post-nerf is sometimes if the board just gets cleared, it struggles for a win condition past Grom.
Jesus.
So I suppose Ragnaros is, like, something else to just push that extra damage late game.
You do see that, what I see?
Yeah, I see a very big Patron board with
oh my God.
Probably 6 Patrons coming out.
You go for it, right?
Of course.
This is the mirror match when who plays the first patron wins, unless your opponent has a tech brawl in it.
Yeah.
Which you saw some time ago when the patron was the dominant deck in the metagame.
Yeah.
No.
You don't see it too often now, though, right? Yep. I've not seen really any new patron decks with brawl in.
With Paladin and Druid also behind, winning this patron mirror could also give you a strong edge to potentially sweep the series. So Garra losing this, assuming it does end up panning that way, would be disastrous,
so
to say
many
the least.
Choices.
What is even more interesting that is that they're both playing the same classes.
Yeah, and it is something to be noted that these three classes seem to be the most powerful. Hoi is also playing these three classes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we do see that Purple and his teammates in Game of Origin took a different approach. So perhaps it's not the only strategy that works, but this is definitely one of the most common that you'll see at the time. Oh man, first Inner Rage, and the second Inner Rage.
What's Garra's face gonna look like?
Well, you know what? I mean,
safe, actually.
Part of it is that at least the 5-1s will get killed by the whirlwind effect. But
he didn't attack with the weapon though.
Yeah,
he chose not to set up his own patron turn because he didn't have an Inner Rage or a whirlwind effect to go with that. It's kind of interesting though, because although he couldn't make obviously as many patrons as RDU. He has 2 patrons in hand, so he could have made a few, maybe if they got cleared, then he could have carried on afterwards.
I'm thinking about it. What was the reason to not attack? I mean,
well, because not attacking so means that he can actually choices. Remove these patrons systematically, as opposed to, like, well, he's caught in a tough position where he has to create more patrons.
By systematically, you just mean one patron.
One patron, you can execute another one.
And that doesn't really do much.
Well, it stops him from Whirlwind blowing you out, though.
There's still 2-3 health patrons on the board after that, and the 1 health as well. It's kind of rough.
Wow.
Go face, that's the answer to a patron board.
Yeah, but he's not playing Hunter.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that.
So, in the end, he's just going to let the patrons...
win?
Well,
no,
maybe get 2-fold, because at this point, if he Whirlwinds, he only has 1 patron that gets created, and maybe he's okay with that.
RDU might even think about slamming one of his patrons here.
The 3-1. The 5-1.
This is insane. I mean... that turn 5 when there's just not even close to enough answers, and to be fair, I don't know if using the Deathbite earlier and then proccing his own patron the following turn would have even been enough to deal with that.
Well, that was fast.
Yeah, it's just how it is. Like, that was the nuts for RDU. He drew that in succession as well. He didn't have the Inner Rage. He only had Deathbite and the patron itself. But Warrior can't answer that without Brawl. In fact, many classes can't answer that at all.
Druid can't answer that. Paladin can't answer that.
Needs a quality and consecration.
Yes. And
unless the spell power comes out of nowhere. The answers that you commonly see are Hellfire or Shadow Flame from Warlock.
Or even just being ahead of board as well. Like if you actually have a board presence, like hopefully your minions can just trade well to just clear the patrons off. But as you said, like other than big AoE or the board ahead of you and in patron, you don't normally have that board early anyway.
It's hard to have a board control, some form of minions on board when your opponent has 2 weapons already.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. Right? Yeah, because you start with Fire
Warax,
right?
He had the Fear
Warax, right?
Into Deathbite and just was clearing minions because Garra played Acolyte of Pain into Frothing Berserk and they were just both removed. Yeah. So whatever minions would have that been...
Yeah, it probably would have had the same outcome, right?
Exactly.
He just drew incredibly well. Probably couldn't have got a better draw.
Yeah, and there's nothing you can do about it, but the consequences are there. Garra now has to fight with Paladin and Druid against the Patron, and if he's playing the standard stuff, like mid-range Paladin, mid-range Druid, he might be in for a very bad time. We'll have to see.
We'll see how it goes. And Gaara will have a tough nut to crack. I still wonder, I mean, Gaara's always perceived as a player that has some kind of surprise in his decks, right? So I wouldn't be surprised that those
those
classes have something weird in the choices.
It is the least Gaara lineup I've seen in a while.
There's no shaman first.
There's no shaman, there's no priest, there's no hunter, and those are the three classes that he loves the most. And he's brought just the decks that he thought was the most powerful.
Well, that's it. He's gone with the root of these decks are actually just good, so really good. So I'm just going to take him and hope that's enough to actually push through.
Well, Ancient of Lore means that it's a mid-range druid. Does he have odd cards? Maybe Harrison Jones. Maybe the Mounted Raptor.
Interesting.
So that card against Warrior is just annoying. It's like Fire War Axe doesn't clear it off, and you might have replaced one Shade of Naxxramas with it.
So why would you play Mounted Raptor instead of a Harvest Golem?
Well, the three attack allows you to trade into a Shredder.
Oh, okay.
And allows you to kill Acolyte of Pain.
Mm-hmm. A lot of the time, the one drop's actually more powerful than a 2-1.
I wouldn't. I'm not sure about the stats, but
I don't know the percentages, are they?
Sure. I think actually the one drop are worse.
Really?
Statistically, because there are so many 1-1s, 1-2 that are not doing anything.
Okay.
Well, there's not actually many 1-mana 1-1s. They're actually usually 1-2s or 2-1s. And then, of course, there are like 1-3s, like Northshire Cleric, Mana Worm, Voidwalker, and then you have even
actually should have done the research.
Kvalde,
in the extreme examples, you have like injured Kvalde, which is like 2-4. In fact, I think that there might be, I'm actually willing to take a bet that there's more 2-mana 1-1s than 1-mana 1-1s. Yeah, do you want to take a bet, Lothar?
Let's
do that.
All right. So what's the loser have to do?
I know what you want to propose.
No, we can do anything.
Go on. Loser
has to wear the crown every time he casts for the rest of the day.
That's the punishment. Wear a crown.
With the balls.
And the problem here is on stream, no one can see what we're talking about, so this could sound very, very strange.
Both balls.
Okay. So balls someone has to post a Twitter post to you and me, and say
the other gets to write. The other gets to write a Twitter post for the other person.
Yeah. That's
okay.
Good.
How about that? So you can do whatever on mine. I can do it on yours.
Okay. That's a good one. All right.
Okay. Anyways, back to the game. Mounted Raptor is very problematic for the Fiery War Axe, but look at this! Ardeus just hits face with the Fiery War Axe.
So, this is Mounted Raptor because the Dinosaur's Aspirant doesn't really do anything.
That is an interesting move.
Okay, that's a very good draw. Both minions will be playing on board, I guess.
There's also a thought as well, seeing the Raptor, either you could think that this is actually a more aggressive druid. Mm-hmm. Because it's not too common to see the Raptor in mid range,
right.
So he might be playing a bit more defensively than he would normally do. Up until the point he sees the next couple of turns, I guess.
I really like that idea. I think there's a lot of merit to it. And now Garen has an opportunity to silence his Acolyte and deny the card draw, which would be paramount to the success of the deck because you don't want the patron to chain draw. It's so snowbally. They draw one card that happens to lead to a battle rage, which happens to lead into the exact curve that they need into Dr. Boom.
Yeah, and the issue is like one of the other players he could do is he could put the Aspirant on the board and Hero Power and trade with the 2-1 to get the taunt down. But as you said, like the Acolyte's then guaranteed two draws at least.
Right, and then you know that he's on a weapon draw. Like, why would he hit face with the Fiery War Axe against Druid? It feels
if
like
you didn't have a backup.
If you don't have, that feels like such a waste. He's not playing Face Warrior, so if you hit with the Fiery War Axe on turn two. It feels there's a strong likelihood he has something like a Death Spite on turn four. But we know. However, does Gaara know? Not to mention that Keeper does end up dying to that anyways.
Wow, that's playing on nerves here. To the last second.
Yeah, tough call, but I think it's correct. Battle Rage, though. It's a pretty great draw.
Pretty amazing, I would say. This is a turn four slam into Battle Rage. You draw four cards.
That is nutty. So you silence the Acolyte to stop it from drawing, but your opponent draws anyways.
Oh, but he goes for the weapon instead. So he wants to set up a more greedy Battle Rage next turn because he goes for the zero mana.
He think it could be aggro.
Yes, that's my.
This is really nice, actually. Even though like you might be playing a bit more defensively, it's still a good play, right? The board's looking pretty nice for the Patron. Mm-hmm.
And that, basically, you say those are my. This is my third copy of Patrons.
Yeah.
Right, because he has those for free, and Druid has a problem to deal with those minions because he would have to use a double Rav combination, maybe a swipe into Living Roots, but he doesn't have to swipe.
Yeah. Garrow also realized that he has to just drop Drake this turn, but the potential for a Battle Rage as well is really high with this mm-hmm. board.
Super high. Although, one thing that is interesting is that Druid's starting to really ramp up in power when having like Force of Nature Savage Word for 7 mana is nothing to scoff at. Mm-hmm. It's a lot.
It's true.
Because he's almost certainly going to play Emperor Thoris the next turn. Unless. Are you
start aggressively now?
Yeah.
Like, oh. Set up the weapon, okay.
He keeps it in case he draws the Patron Warrior. I like that. Oh, sorry, not the warrior, but draw the Grim Patron. He draws his own. Derp. Well, Emperor Thorsen makes the combo into 7 mana. The Force of Nature becomes 5.
But you're getting pretty low.
Yeah, the issue here is you made the combo cheaper to then combo to just defend. So it's pretty rough.
Look at that double grip from RDU on that juice. Wow.
You made your whole hand cheaper, though, and now Living Roots becomes 0. That's pretty effective for how you can squeeze in your mana the following turn, because I feel like the only other alternative here is just Force of Nature, or just like Keeper and the Living Roots, and both of those options feel like you're using your mana inefficiently if you use Keeper here.
But and you're not putting enough on the board either. Like, you're not really afraid of the 2/4 with a weapon.
Yeah.
From Garo's perspective, I would say Emperor's greedy. But it's probably the winning play, while Keeper and Living Roots seems weak, but it's way safer.
Yeah. That's a really good assessment. I think he's maybe questioning the Darnassus. It's just another minion to challenge the Dread Corsair. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't have the Living Roots. Living Roots might be useful for killing the Grim Patron on this turn.
But that's a perfect draw for RDU. The slam will make the weapon able to clear the board while still having a 3/1 minion on board. And I don't think
I
that's actually
okay. But I think you just play the Gnomish if you
you have Inner Rage. Yeah. You have time to play Gnomish actually. It's a better minion. Deals more damage, and you will have three. Will be at 16, 14.
That is
if the 3/1 will survive the next turn or just deal another damage to the face, even with the hero power, so set up at 14, that's actually lethal with Inner Rage Gromash, but it's still two turns away.
Alright, so he reduces his hand count here, getting some decent cards. The Force of Nature Savage Roar might be a really valuable card to just clear the Grim Patrons, just like the old days, but the difference being that right now RDU is just so far ahead in the resource count, and it's not going to stop anytime soon.
And he will use Whirlwind double Armor Smith this turn to just, Armor Smith Whirlwind turn to just gain basically a hero power for 1 mana, and he will kill the Emperor next turn. Unless he just wants to sacrifice the Gnomish Inventor and set up a lethal with just the Gromash and Inner Rage and attack from the weapon.
But yeah, I kind of like the Whirlwind, because he's got the Grom proc anyway, like, why not?
Yeah.
Well, he has the proc from the fall on weapon.
Okay, so. But having the minion against Druid is almost always better.
Yeah.
Alright, without a swipe here, he's going to be in some pretty big trouble.
I think even with a swipe, he's dead, right?
Yeah.
You're right.
He needed some form of taunt and clear to
and that's not it. So RDU's like, yeah, all right, well, 2-0. And Gara realizes, well, this is probably what happens when you lose the Patron Mirror and you're playing a lineup with almost the exact same classes. He's going to need Paladin to 3-0. Otherwise, his tournament life's over.
Do we know what type of Paladin is?
I would bet it's Secret.
Yeah, I would bet on Secrets.
It's not like we've not seen Secret Paladin 3-0 in this tournament so far.
Yeah,
that's true. But we have seen exactly the same situation with both players having the same classes. And the Paladin Mirror was the deciding match for the match. because they didn't have exact counter to the paladin, to the secret paladin.
I don't know. I think Patron Warrior is very good against the
but in that
paladin
matchup, there was no Patron Warrior.
Oh, gotcha. But yeah, in this case, the first matchup is going to really decide everything. We might realistically have time for a second series finally.
Yeah. Can actually jump into the second game.
Well, with that hand, that is pretty decent. You don't really want secrets early on, but Noble Sacrifice is one of the secrets that gives Warrior fits, generally speaking. Yeah. And, I mean, Competitive Spirit, Avenge, those are cards that aren't bad with Muster for Battle.
Yeah, the Noble Sacrifice defends against the Fiery War Axe, and then next turn you can just play both the two other secrets into Muster. And then, like you said, it's actually one of the few sort of lineups of cards that work together quite well.
Wow! No way! RDU is back. That is the RDU I knew from last DreamHack when he won. Like that's the exact kind of draws he needs to win. But you know what? This sets up Competitive Spirit and Avenge for the following turn, too. And, I mean, Gar is pretty upset because that would have been a 4-5 Secret Keeper otherwise. But
that's a Yeti for one mana.
Yeah.
I mean, Undertaker's back.
I was anticipating that maybe RDU had to execute that thing, but no need at all.
He's just drawing all the secrets, actually. Has he drawn one of every secret now?
Except for Repentance.
Oh, yeah, Repentance.
And RDU's like, well, there's a really high chance that it's basically the exact hand the exact sequence of secrets that I don't like.
I'm surprised that he uses the Floating Berserker instead of the weapon to kill the Noble Sacrifice.
Is it not so the weapon can kill the Avenge target?
Yeah, I think that's
the
reason.
So otherwise the Avenge trades.
Right. What I'm talking about.
Sorry.
Yeah, that was really stupid of me.
Yeah, it doesn't normally look right, but
The Dread Corsair. Wow. This is nutty.
This is nuts.
This is nutty. There's almost nothing Gar can do here. He needs Consecration off the top, and that could bring him back in.
Oh, let's
see what
he
can actually clear off the Berserker. He can clear the board, which is okay.
Well, he has
Mysterious Chunk.
He has a good 6 and 8.
He's just going to get there without falling too far behind.
What RDU needs is an Acolyte of Fame right now. Because he needs to get back with the cards because double. Oh, God.
One Battle Rage is still kind of an Acolyte.
So he'll draw exactly what he needs, right?
That's not bad. It's not contested by the board.
Okay,
yeah.
The second Battle Rage is pretty important because that might be the limit of your card draw. Every other thing in the deck is at best cycling versus Battle Rage actually can fill your hand.
Yeah.
You know, Gnomish Adventure. Even Acolyte Pain immediately drawing, it's like those cards are really hard to break more than even.
So he has the 6, 7, 8 all secret paladins once.
Yeah.
Just nothing beforehand, which is pretty rough.
Which might even be the way to win this game.
I think it could, on the flip side, RDU doesn't have anything. That Ghoul's a little bit annoying, but not a threat. The weapons, again, if he top decks a patron, then maybe there's an issue.
But if he like gets Whirlwind, there's just nothing.
Yeah.
I mean, this is like kind of a weak turn because he only has 4 mana left.
There's the patron for next turn.
The 2 draw is really important, but now it's like Mysterious Challenger is out before the patrons, which is really
nice. Which is huge. Because then because the Mysterious Challenger comes out and there's obviously no charge for patrons anymore, he can set the patrons up, but then you just do whatever you do after the proper Mysterious Challenger. And then just play Boo, and then just play Tyrion, and then it's just, okay, deal with all this. There are executes, but even having to put in 2 patrons to prop the executes, for example, is going to be rough.
Alright, we'll see though. I mean, now we're starting some real power turns. This is kind of like the Hunter saving High Man, so to speak. Wow, Gar is just. I think Gar is tilted. You can just see he's taking like 2 seconds to make his turn. He's just not really.
You really?
Hang on, hang
2
on.
Seconds to make a turn with you have Mysterious Challenger into Dr. Boom into Chuyun.
No,
I bet
I mean,
you $100.
Leading
you
up
can
to
really
it.
Make
look,
another
look,
play.
Gar, I will not take that. Good thing that he played the Acolyte first. If he played Grim Patron, it would have been sad.
That's like the snipe to the face for the patron.
Exactly. And now he has to execute. This is part of the reason why we're talking about getting the Grim Patrons before the Challenger's problem. Is what you want to do. Doing it afterwards is problematic because you just lose tempo and you lose time. Because now it's like, sure, you dealt with this, but guess what comes afterwards and what comes after that? And you know what? With the deck being thinned out by 3 cards, I mean, you don't know. Maybe he just draws another threat like Challenger or Lotheb, or even just like Blessing of Kings on his mini bot. Like, that's still really powerful. Garrosh is not. Literally, okay, if we were to keep a track of the timer on the turns, RDU, I would has probably like 3, 4, 5 minutes, and Garrosh probably still on his first minute.
Yeah, 30 seconds.
So it seems like a turn when you just play Patron and
Women. And boom bots. Or you can Patron and tuck it behind the Unstable Coin.
Well, yes. And but you can Whirlwind anyway.
Would you play both first on the off chance that it shoots your Unstable Ghoul and copies your Patron?
I'm actually thinking about it. It might be the case that you attack phase.
You save execute by doing that.
And you save execute for next turn. Oh god, this is a really tough decision.
The problem as well is we've seen both Battle Rages, so it's not like it's like, right, okay, I'm going to throw all my hand onto the board, but I'll draw later. It's like, he really won't, so this is pretty all in, actually.
Here we go, here we go.
I do like the ghoul, though, because, like, the problem is without it, the boom bots can just kill your patrons.
Let's see when the bombs are going. Oh my god!
Another patron? That's okay. Oh, that's really bad. The sequence of that was so bad! It's okay, though. He's got Coghammer, and he's got Tyrion. Those are two things. Actually, he doesn't need Coghammer this turn. He can just Tyrion, kill off a patron, and then go to town.
Would you, with one card in the warrior's hand, would you actually just use Boom to kill one of the other patrons as well?
Yeah.
Because like they just have two patrons on board, and then two cards after the draw. Like, what are you afraid of with Tyrion?
Yeah.
And then you just follow up with Coghammer, and he's also got, like, now he's gone into Shredder and Minibot. There's so much power in this hand. I like this a lot.
Dang! Oh, and he was like, "Now," and he draws his Grommash, which, I mean, that does help control a little bit of the state of the board, but it's very, very hard to get past the Divine Shield with Taunt.
Well, you have to sacrifice your patrons to do that.
I know.
Ah, that's awkward.
Yeah, and then it's just going to be Coghammer kill Grommash if he uses Grom.
Yeah, Tyrion gains back his Divine Shield.
No, it's 9 HP, right?
Yeah, because he can Grom, prop the shield with Grom, and then put both patrons in.
Yeah.
But then he's just going to Coghammer
He can Coghammer whatever comes out, or he can just use the weapon too. Like, he's actually just really safe, I think. Because he has to trade this into.
But he loses the weapon also that he got from Tyrion. I mean, the problem is RDU is out of steam. His deck is low value from now point. Because he has no ways of just getting more cards in the cycle. And
the second minibot's pretty nice as well.
The problem might be.
Well, RDU's used a Death Spike here.
Yeah,
so
but
he
even
doesn't have much
doesn't
weapon
really
burn.
Do much.
I mean, Shield Block is something to spend mana into it.
Into more cycle.
Spends more mana.
In a rage?
Into nothing.
The problem with Patron at this point is it's singular top decks do almost nothing. Because even like you got to cycle cards there, but like he's still got one card in hand, and one card alone normally does nothing.
Well, I mean, RDU rode, like took the car until the wheels fell off, but now he needs a jet. Because this is one hell of a board that's starting to build up here. That's 9. 12, 13, 15. That's a lot of damage. He's going to be doing upwards to almost 20 damage as soon as he's building up a little bit more. So, like, what is he really hoping for? He needs weapon burn.
Second Keeper. Interesting. Now, does Gaara wants to show the Second Keeper? I don't think so, right? He has the board control.
Yeah.
He doesn't need that. He can just attack phase with the five weapon. With the five attack weapon and just play Coghammer to be fully insured.
As long as he has a two-turn lethal, which I think he should have it, because this is
I think it's done 15.
This is 14 on board, yeah, and then 15 plus the hero power. That's a great target.
Yeah, that works.
Wow, the Secrets Paladin withstood it, and we're talking about how the 6-8 curve is kind of like playing the double high mains and really putting pressure on the warrior. That was power swings. The patron was not able to withstand because they weren't able to get the Grim Patrons before the Mysterious Challenge at first.
And the Boombot sequencing actually changes a lot as well to reduce down the volume of Boombots. The volume of Patrons. There's one more back. And like we said, we've seen a lot of secret piles in 3-0. So there is a chance. There's definitely a chance.
Now RDU has to answer with his Paladin most likely, because the mirror match will be probably a better chance of winning this match than going with Druid.
But I wonder what version RDU is playing, because there's the defensive version and then there's the aggressive version. And every time I play the defensive version, unless I manage to curve absolutely perfectly with Chao and Minibot, I always feel a little scared, because the aggressive version with things like the Keeper of Oldemon for board tempo, or in this case, playing Secret Keeper first and your opponent like buffs Secret Keeper because of secrets. I don't know. That kind of stuff always makes me really scared.
But RDU starts with the Druid, which is having a really good opening hand. I mean, Rav, Darnassus, Aspirant, the Keeper.
That is pretty good. He even holds on to the Keeper, so that way he can curve very nicely.
And also, it deals with any sort of early Avenge targets as well. You can just get rid of them pretty easy with the Silence, if he feels that much under pressure anyway.
Yep. So here's an interesting choice. So he chooses to go for Noble Sacrifice because he thinks this is his only way to deal with Darnassus Aspirant. And in a way, he's correct. Oh, RDU has two Aspirants. And most likely the second one might not be played if he just waits for a Darnassus Aspirant on turn two.
Yeah, for sure
two
you
coin,
played,
right?
Yeah, definitely coin out the first Darnassus Aspirant because it gives you so much potential. Place in set in the turn four. I mean, basically turn three, because we'll have four mana, so you can play both Wrath and.
I'll never tell.
Yeah, this is. I guess you want to bait out a Wrath. He's hoping.
Yeah, I think this is fine though. This is fine for RDU because having the Wrath in hand makes the Aspirant so much safer.
It's true.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm saying for Gaara, he was hoping that the Darnassus Aspirant would attack first.
Yeah.
I'm sure that the Darnassus will not attack here. Oh, action attack. Okay. I was sure that he will not do that because he has the Keeper for next turn, so he will play around Last of a Battle. That's interesting. But he plays around Avenge.
Yeah.
And that's even maybe more important, because if there's a combo of Noble Sacrifice and Avenge, you're sure that you are playing around that.
Thorsen!
And obviously by attacking, he saw it wasn't Redemption as well, without wrapping down, so he was, you know, the odds are it's going to be the Noble Sacrifice. And Thorsen on turn 4, it's pretty okay.
It
especially is. With Ancient Lore in hand.
But it's not... I mean, you can actually just keep Revoltamon, and that's not as big of a deal. It's more of the cards are getting reduced that are really big. The fact that he has Ancient of Lore, that's most likely going to go down to 5 mana. But
you can keep her. You can keep her the Emperor to heal it to maximum health and stats after trading.
None may steal our stars.
You know what I mean? You can kill the 3/4. You have a 3/3. Sorry. No, you can't. Never mind.
I thought that he was going to pop the bubble and then use the Keeper on the Emperor.
The problem with that is, though, like, the Emperor stays regardless, right?
Yeah, so I guess.
Because
really
he still
matter.
Couldn't be killed.
So he just wants to make the biggest mini-bot as possible, but then this gets silenced.
This works really well into it, because so the silence is the Aspirant. There's multiple important targets in the form of the Aspirant and the Emperor, and there's just, like, guaranteed next turn Ancient of Lore.
Oh, that True Server Champion, though, is not a bad draw. And with the second Keeper of Oldemon, that Ancient of Lore is actually manageable.
That just shows how important the Keeper of Oldemon in this deck.
That's keeping him in the game!
Yeah. Otherwise, he would not be able to clear.
Wago's a bad draw here, I guess. He'd rather have minions. That's one of them. Drew the Claw in.
And a positive hitter. But that's a good cure for Gaara.
Going into Boom.
Hero power into Uldumman to kill the Ancient of Law, so you don't lose the Knife Juggler, and you can still have a combo of Masterful Battle, right? Oh, okay. So he pushes.
In this ideal scenario, it actually hits the
Keeper, right?
Oh
whoa!
My god! And now Boom, Dr. Boom might be able to do some wonderful magical things.
It has to, at this point, I think, for Gaara. Unless he goes straight into Boom Tyrion.
There's the combo in hand for 8 mana. And a liftoff!
It's a little premature for
that. We have a problem.
No need to celebrate on either side here. I mean, RDU's not exactly guaranteed a win, but Gaara's not out of the woods. He's on one card. And he's now on the position where it's like every Paladin's fear is that you might just draw secrets from this point on.
He will draw
else.
Tyrion.
Yeah. It would be. Especially because he actually drew a few secrets earlier on, so he kind of got that out of the way.
Gotcha.
He hopes, I imagine. What do you do? You just drop Druid of the Claw here, right?
Yeah, I don't
Shredder Hero Power doesn't really do anything.
I guess you could argue Shredder Wild Growth. But I think it's Druid of the Claw stats match up better.
Yeah, because the Alderman kills the Shredder anyway. Oh, like the first half at least.
The Wild Growth allows you to Force of Nature Savage Roar, but that won't even get you to the lethal range.
Yeah, you're not close enough to finish the game.
I think you can keep that for the draw, but I'm not sure.
Okay. I don't
know. Just go for it, okay. Does that open anything up potential for next turn with the Druid of the Claw? So it'll be on.
I don't know, Savage Roar, but this is really tough. I guess what it does open up is a big game hunter off the top. Swipe is what it's going to be, though.
Okay.
And.
Well, he is able to kill the Dr. Booms. That's at least something.
Yeah, but it can't develop because.
So you would rather go for Druid of the Claw?
I mean, it's. No, I'm saying. Probably. I don't know, man. Force Nature Savage Roar also is in some position where he still has Boom Bots, but you do clear everything. Almost. Because the 2-4. Oh, he's going to go
he's
all phase.
He has Druid of the Claw charge and swipe next turn, right?
Oh, man. That could get punished by Cog Hammer.
Is it? Because you can still swipe and Hero Power.
No, Cog Hammer.
Yeah, because he only has 9 mana next turn. So you'd need Druid. Would swipe hit?
Yeah, but you don't die in 2 turns against a Paladin.
So I think that's it then, because this Noble Sacrifice? Challenger will pull out Noble Sacrifice, but you have your hero. Oh no, he doesn't have enough mana to do everything. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right, because those cards weren't reduced by Emperor Thor. So the Noble Sacrifice is actually really good.
Oh
wow, not
and
a
that's really small.
And that's 4 damage to the face.
Oh,
what?
Is the Paladin next?
What? Merry Christmas, are you? From Germany with love.
Well, that's kind of annoying for RDU.
Yeah, he needed like Keeper of the Grove off the top in order to like end it, guaranteed. Now what do? Do you have to Wrath to draw for something else? Because clearly your hand's not going to cut it, but even if you drew the exact card you need, it has to be Living Roots.
Yeah,
like,
I think
that's it.
Have we seen one Living Roots so far? Oh, no, we've not seen
Garra's
Druid. We've not seen any in this game.
If RDU doesn't have Living Roots, how is he supposed to end? Because now he's aware that just with minions on the board, he's going to die.
Wait, what if he just attacks... plays Druid with the Claw in taunt form, then attacks with the Hero Power, kills the Noble Sacrifice, then triggers the Avenge, Redemption, plays the Wrath to kill...
Are you hoping for the Avenge onto the bench?
I think he's got to dig with Wrath for something.
Oh, that...
And he's triggering
Redemption
Avenge.
The bomb.
And the Redemption of the Bomb!
Oh my god, that's really risky.
No! That's not going to do anything! And RDU's out of time! Wow. This game just took a very big left turn here, and Garra's looks like he's going to... Even if the series ends in game 5? Wow. RDU is not happy with how that ended up going. That's it.
That looks so one-sided for so long as well.
It did.
And
it's
then
like,
it was just
well,
like, oh, by the way, mysterious challenge.
He got the Darnassus Aspirant ramp, and he got it into an Innervate Thorsen, but the draw of the mysterious challenger, instead of a secret itself, was such a big deal that
Garra
was able to equalize it.
I think as well, like drawing the Wild Growth just didn't. Was too dead, and then it actually took the next draw to draw into the Shredder and the Druid of the Claw, which didn't get reduced by Thorsen because they were too late.
I wonder if that ends up being a difference maker here. What do you think, Lothar? The Shredder Wild Growth versus Druid of the Claw? Because the thing about it is that if he didn't Wild Growth, he wouldn't have the mana to swipe Shredder anyways. He'd be at 7 mana.
Mm-hmm.
But he still could have comboed afterwards with the Druid of the Claw.
He didn't have enough mana to combo either.
I think the Wild Growth was a correct decision because it was important to push for lethal. I mean, if there wouldn't be a top deck with Mysterious Challenger or Coghammer, the game was practically done. And RDU made the correct decision to just go aggressively, unlike that combo on turn 7, basically.
My god. Well, Garra has Divine Favor also in this deck and 2 Keepers of Ulamon. That's a lot of tech. Yeah. RDU, in the meantime, is going to be looking for that early game curve. So, I mean, Consecration is a card that I always think whether or not to keep it, but I just realized it's too slow. Oh, wait, hold on. He's playing mid-range Paladin.
Yeah, I guess so.
We saw a heal bot, right?
We saw
the Murloc Knight.
Well, that's great for Gaara's curve, but RDU is going to be hoping that he has something to do on three other than hero power.
Gaara's playing Ragnaros in this list as well. He's playing this in Ragnaros in this, and he played Ragnaros in Patron, right?
Well, Ragnaros is not really the best against Paladin, but you know, it's funny.
It's a great deck against freeze mages.
Yeah, that is true. Is he just putting Ragnaros in every deck?
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe that's
he doesn't want to get swept by freeze mage.
It's interesting. It's an interesting point though, because like when you come into tournament, he may not play Ragnaros on ladder or anything. But when you come into a tournament like this and expect certain decks, like cards like Ragnaros might slip in just to, like you said, counter a deck like freeze mage that you might expect. Mm-hmm.
So, RD has two consecrations, and that's really big.
Oh, Gaara goes for the Masterful Battle. Wow.
Yeah, it's on curve. Reporting it's something that, yeah, I think you generally want to do that. And he plays around consecration by not popping his own Haunted Creeper as well. It makes a lot of sense. So now RDU still can't get a full clear, but almost certainly has to consecrate something, right? You can't leave this much on the board.
No. I agree. You have to go for the consecration here.
Shredder just feels too greedy.
What do you trade in with, though, with the Creeper? Do you go into the other Creeper or the Divine Shield?
Yeah, because then you have your 2/1/1s on the board with you. Even though one dies to the Knight's Justice, you still have the second one to pop the Divine Shield. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah, Divine Shield. Yeah.
Well, I think it's fine because one single target is easier for Pal to deal with than a single, than 2/1/1 spread out.
Yeah.
Because if you have 2/1/1s, they control hero power board much better than just a single target because they can always
you're always one ahead.
Yeah, you're always one ahead. So. Well, Sludge Belcher draw gives a pretty decent response on board, but then you don't deal with the Knife Juggler. So this is a point where RDU has to fathom, is this a worth consecrating again?
I kind of like this because next turn he has a few options. He can add hero power.
Keeper Voldemon though, and we're right back in Dr. Boom! He's ready for 7. All he has to get is one mysterious challenger, and we have gone through the complete circle of unbelievable draws.
Being
this
able
series.
To just slip the repentance in there as well is pretty big, because you come up to turn 6.
Oh,
where,
you're right.
You know, where there's a lot of normally big minions. Like, you look at the Sludge Belcher, even the Murloc Knight, and because you have the 1/1 on the board and you've got the Light's Justice, you're just going to insta kill anything that gets dropped now.
Yeah, I guess the only thing that's bad is maybe Sylvanas. You don't actually want Sylvanas to have 1 HP to steal the board, right? Sometimes you want it to have
kind
a little
of
bit
board,
more.
Yeah, I think it's not too dangerous. Because you'd hero power first, right? Because he doesn't have anything.
I guess so. Repentance lands, and well, maybe the charging Murloc would be really good here for RDU, especially old Murkite to snipe this 3/3. No, Quillite Seer is definitely about average, though. That is a bad turn for Gaara, and that could be an opportunity for RDU to turn back the game.
But is it powerful enough for turn 7 for RDU to take it like around? You know, he has the Peacekeeper for Dr. Boom.
Peacekeeper and Shredder? That's assuming he doesn't Peacekeeper now for board tempo. Because it's like, well, he didn't do anything on 6 mana. What can my opponent not do for 6 mana? On turn 7.
I wonder.
I think you gotta keep this Alder's Peacekeeper.
That looks like a Knife Juggler into Belcher.
Yep.
And the perfect scenario is to snipe the 1/1.
No. Hit face is probably one of the worst options.
Yeah, it is. Definitely it is, because it doesn't help him with trading with the little slime from the Belcher.
Here's a question. You're going to be killing off the Belcher and playing Boom, but would you trade in a way that makes that the Keeper of Voldemon might come back? Or would you keep the Spider alive? Because you can use the 3/2 to trade in. Oh, okay. He chooses to just do that. Because I was thinking you can use the Spider in, and then you might get Keeper of Voldemon back as a 3/1 as opposed to a 1/1. But I guess this makes it so that Redemption may even have the Boombot come back, and that's pretty good redemption, I think, considering what it could hit. Man, this is tough for RDU. He's gonna go ahead and pick off his trade first, so he can activate redemption. Also, if that was Avenge, then he could have it land on Dr. Boom potentially and shut it down.
So he goes for the Defend of Argus this turn, right?
Almost certainly, although I was wondering if he was going to use Keeper of Uldumon on Boom as well. But
feels like it's more important to have the Keeper of Uldumon on targets with Avenge.
Yeah, makes the most sense.
Let me think.
But it's such a weird situation, especially when you didn't have the Nightfall of course. Okay.
That juggle could be really important if it lands one more time on that 3-1.
Pile to Shredder this then?
Also, with the Keeper of Uldumon, Ragnos is not really that big of a threat.
Yeah, I like Pile to Shredder, though. Juggle gonna go.
Wow!
Oh my god, that was really huge.
That was. Oh my god!
One good draw! And that juggle hit the boom butt! Here we go! Fireworks!
Did someone say turn 7 Boom, turn 8 Tyrion?
Oh my god, Gaara is just having the best draws possible ever.
I mean, there's been some crazy draws back and forth this series, but none bigger potentially than this Tyrion. Because there's not an answer to it. I guess there is in the shape of the Keeper of Uldumon, but there's a 5 damage weapon coming out on the other side. Nardi was like, you got that curve without Mysterious Challenger? How are you so good? The answer to that is, I don't even know, man.
He's definitely been watching High play this
Yeah,
weekend.
Man, that's the key. The extra painful thing about this Keeper of Uldumon is, sure, it makes you let you deal with the minion, but you don't even deal with Divine Shield, which still trades
None
perfectly into the board.
Do you attack when
you need to?
Yeah.
It doesn't change anything, right?
Yeah, so that's why you just hold on to it. There's nothing that's actually benefiting from it.
But the Ragnaros now.
Ragnaros
might seal the deal for Gaara. There's no answer from RDU unless he top decks the Big Game Hunter. I mean,
yeah.
The problem is.
Wait, he has stall though.
But the weapon from the Tyrion is 15 damage to the face.
Assuming he can get that weapon easily, I mean that's quite the barrier that's blocking Gaara right now. And also, if Ragnaros hits face, he's got heal by the stall. All right. I mean, basically any of those three attacks.
Yeah,
there
weren't really
the
good
same.
Yeah. Any bad targets in
I
that one?
I guess if he really wanted to, he wanted to hit the Belcher, but that's definitely.
I suppose the only thing there is, if he helps Belcher, then he still gets the sludge to pop the shield, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's still.
Ooh, this Divine Shield pop could be big.
Reporting for duty. See if it hurts.
No. But one more chance. One more chance.
My shield for
and by doing this.
Oh my god, he hits it. So he can. Wait, what if he just races here?
Yeah, I mean, what if he doesn't have enough time to actually benefit off the weapon? That's what I was saying. That's 4 damage to the face, put him 10. Oh, he's taking it really safe. Really hoping no concentration.
I think that was because he traded with the Belcher and not the Keeper.
Now, sorry to interrupt you, but weapon into weapon.
With Ashbringer.
That is really bad draw for Gaara now. So he got the power trio a few times, but the Cockhammer might just override here the 5-3 weapon. Don't you want to attack first?
I think it matters, right? Is he just gonna
attack? He's playing every single weapon!
Oh my god.
Oh, that's so funny, man. I can't get over that. What kind of turn was that?
He needed
that's
to do
this.
He wished all
there.
Of those were Death Spite. Alright, he snipes the Sludge Belcher, and RDU is on a draw to potentially win here. Lothep and Healbot is pretty good. It's not bad. It's like some of the best.
Wow.
2 5 drops is what you usually get.
That was
really good.
Hilarious. That's more weapons
Man,
than
Harrison
the Warrior.
Jones is like, where am I?
Is this the museum already? I'm not needed here.
Yeah.
And Rena Jackson's just saying, we're going to be rich.
What more strange is it wasn't like a troll play. It was actually the right play to play those weapons in that order.
Yeah, but
yeah,
it's not good, but it was the correct play with what
he
had. He
basically
like
played Cockhammer as a Divine Shield taunt.
Yeah.
Yes.
Then he played Muster for Battle
summon three,
to summon 3/3s, and then he just played Chooser Champion for a weapon.
But the Tyrion was like, okay, just play me as a 6/6 Divine Taunt minion.
I mean, I bet he just, if he had one Blade Flurry, that would have just been like, yeah, crazy stuff. Ragnaros taking everything and going to try to see if he can reset the board. And gonna put it on hope that his opponent doesn't draw the Mysterious Challenger, because that is Gaara's last hope.
Divine Favor, the worst possible
draw. And that, is that still it? No, he was alive by 2 HP.
Oh my god, what a game. This is one of the, I think it's even closer than the game between Ekop and Zelda.
It's really close. And already used both consecrations. You need 2 silver off the top, something to do 2 damage. Dr. Boom is excellent, and it's about time that he answered his own threat, because Garud has been drawing these big bombs back to back to back, and even Mysterious Challenger probably won't save him now.
What a game.
What a game. Yeah, handshakes across, really tight back and forth, but RDU will stay alive in the tournament, and Gaara looks like he's going to drop here. Once again, one series out from advancing. And DreamHack Summer, he was the same exact thing. I think he had a 5-2 score, and only 6-1s were moving on to next round.
RDU is my teammate, but I feel bad for Gaara. He's always in the top or very near the top when it comes to major tournaments, and just, you know, feels bad. Feels bad for him.
Yeah.
It's definitely tough because both these guys, you can picture them going through, but only one of them did. But in the end, you know, they lost 3 times.
Yeah, I think that's
it's kind of like their own fault, so to speak. It's like, you know,
at this stage in the tournament, it's like almost all the match. I've spoken to some of the players beforehand. It's like, oh, do you know who you've got yet? And they're like, no, but it doesn't really matter because everyone's good. You know, you look at the list of players around this elimination, and because there's just so many good players here, like, you're going to get a lot of upsets like this. Like you said, you could see them both in the top 8 easy.
Makes sense. Yep. Makes sense. Well, RDU wins quite the nail biter. I think that was just like, the very beginning of the series, RDU got amazing draws. And then towards the second half, Garo was getting the amazing draws. And in the end, it's just like, very small things like